Everybody. It's already 10 minutes late, so I'd like to start this panel, World Anthropologies Today. Could you be seated, please? Okay. Do you hear me? Okay, thank you. Now, this is the G55 World Anthropologies Today. This session was convened by Susana Narotzky of the Universitat de Barcelona and Gustavo Ribeiro of Universitat de Brasilia. I am Junji Koizumi, Secretary General of the IUAES, and I asked to be the chair of this session because I'm okay. All right, sorry. because I'm going to be the chair because I'm the Secretary General on the side of the IUAES, and also I'm involved in the WCAA as the former chair of that organization. This symposium, or roundtable should be, was organized by the, well, sponsored by the WCAA. Now the objective is, stated as the abstract in the program. In 2003, the Wenner-Gren Foundation International Symposium, World Anthropologies, Disciplinary Transformations Within Systems of Power, which is a historical meeting, was held in Italy. Then in 2006, the homonymous book was published. The symposium and the book expressed in theoretical and political terms some of the positions of a larger international group called the World Anthropologies Network. 10 years after, we want to appraise and discuss their theoretical, practical, and political impacts. Do we now have more horizontal and plural heteroglossic worldwide relationships among anthropological communities? Is the Anglo-American disciplinary hegemony more open to other influences? Have South-South conversations increased? This and other questions will be discussed by some of the most influential voices of the world anthropologies and other related global debates. And the participants of the audience will also be highly appreciated. So we start with the first presentation by Dr. Francine Saillant of Laval University. The title is World Anthropologies and the Frank World Anthropology.
Yes. Okay. It's a pleasure. So I'm supposed to talk about world anthropologies and the Franco-world anthropology. Few French and Francophone anthropologists consider direct inclusion in section in serious links within the WCAA before 2010, especially based on the presence of existing national organization of anthropologists. Before 2000, we had, for instance, different conflicting associations in France, a very small organization in Quebec, Canada, and an association, the CASCA, the Canadian Association of Anthropology, with few Francophone members. So, nevertheless, I will attempt to present the experience of a group of Francophone anthropologists, friends of the WCAA, who is, in this context, made a kind of exception by creating the FIA, writing the Lausanne Manifesto, and creating the Anthropen project about what I will talk. The experience of Anthropologie et Société, being an international journal that was born and has lived within and from the periphery, mainly French-Canadian, in the Anglo and Franco world, inside and outside the Americas, is important to relate here. This experience, now going back 35 years, has been one of publishing and networking. From an code A from serious agencies, and has maintained its roots, its role, sorry, as a leading Francophone journal in the Americas and beyond. Anthropologie et Société was also the first Francophone anthropological journal to be entirely published in French on the net in open access under my editorship. In 2007, after 30 years of publication, the journal held a conference on the theme of globalization. The idea was to bring anthropologists together using French as a tool for scientific communication to discuss the consequences of globalization within anthropology, but also to use this platform to discuss some of the positive aspects of globalization for the affirmation of new trend in the discipline. Among others, this includes the recognition of other anthropologies, or what we will call here word anthropologies. Related issues discussed in French and within the French intellectual tradition were a plus, irrespective of the results. Considering the rather cool reception, or more precisely, the rejection of post-colonial thinking in Franco-French anthropology, the 2007 conference was a kind of political act. Many publications emerged from this conference, among others, but it is also what you can see, but it also gave rise to the idea of creating a forum to pursue our fruitful discussion of these matters. Anthropologists like François Laplantine, Mondeur Kilani, Irène Bellier, Pierre-Joseph Laurent, and our host, Gustavo Ribeiro, were invited to publish in those pages. A French-speaking group of anthropologists with strong intellectual affinities emerged from the 2007 conference and held a meeting in 2008 at Neuchâtel, at the Ethnographic Museum in Switzerland, of Neuchâtel, yes, following the Anthropologie et Société conference with the project of building up an association. The interest of founding an international association, namely the FIA, or Forum International des Anthropologues, was unanimous. We wanted to link together outside Franco-French associations without excluding our French friends, but while ensuring a real international Francophone organization of anthropologists. Many meetings were held to help along the creation of this project, including workshop and conference between 2008 and 10, also with some members of the WCAA. The association was created, but several difficulties led the project to a kind of standstill. Why? First, we took into account the existence of the WCAA, a sister and friend organization with whom we share many ideas. Why not join the WCAA without founding our own association? But we had to be an association. And a problem arose. Was it possible to reach some of our goals with the principle of the lingua franca within the WCAA? Maybe not. How to deal with the duality of the local global within our future association? Was it worthwhile to struggle for a French specificity and for being a force within the WCAA? I was the person who introduced the WCAA to my French-speaking colleagues. I should note the collaborative efforts we undertook with the WCAA and the FIA between 2008 and 10 by creating special sessions and workshops in national and international conferences. Second, what was our future?
in light of the ongoing creation of a new association of French anthropologists, the AFEA. Why another association of French-speaking anthropologists? How was it possible to harmoniously justify the two projects created in parallel? What were the best means to reach our goal, which was to affirm and reaffirm the necessity of the discipline in the new context of power relationships in the globalizing world, to express it in French, but not at the exclusion of other languages, including English? We also wish to invite our colleagues from World Anthropologies to the discussion. Instead of struggling for a new association, we ultimately abandoned the creation of the FIA and put our energy into bringing together our ideas and epistemological logic in the context of another project. At a meeting we had in Lausanne in 2010, I suggest the idea of writing a manifesto, keeping in mind the globalizing world in the scientific field of anthropology, as well as the challenge of new intellectual trends such as those proposed by the WCAA and World Anthropologies, post-colonial thinking, and some problems emerging in different countries surrounding the increasingly fragile state of our discipline. Soon after the creation of the FIA, the association became no more than a project and was dissolved, the project of the manifesto get under the way. Talking about the manifesto, I won't resume it here, but just note some questions we shared. Would it be possible to produce a non-authoritarian anthropology? Study group produce knowledge and demand a place for this knowledge. Our intent was to assert the place of deep knowledge about culture from deep culture and deep knowledge to deep relationships. We also wished to question classical universalism by considering the idea of the initial project of anthropology reruns, revisiting from the standpoint of the epistemological alternatives now offered to us, namely though other knowledge projects than those based out of the West. The conditions needed for a non-hegemonic anthropology would ultimately consist in a relational and dialogical anthropology, one that is multi-situated in terms of place from which cultural particularisms and their knowledge are being articulated. An anthropology that would nevertheless not silently pass over the conflict and stakes of the hierarchies underpinning the types of relationships involved in the discipline. The effort implies going from the miniature to the fresco mural, from expressions of diversity to their universal use. It is about going beyond interaction and making the epistemological wager that our contact leads us not only to other, but also to their knowledge. After all, is it not important to take into account the experience and especially the knowledge developed from subalternity to be able to recast a critical vision of anthropology? Anthropology has left aside post-colonial criticism. Can it now reformulate it in its own terms? This effort of placing the other of oneself at the heart of theory, rather than making it good material for thought, and not thinking that we hold a monopoly over critical thinking, requires that we give new meanings to the idea of defamiliarization. Taking up these ideas, our manifesto was written by three authors, myself included, Mander Kilani, and then the entire group was invited to write entries to refine and clarify our proposed text while respecting our internal pluralism. The manifesto was launched at the AAA and the AFEA, the French Association, among others, in 2011. Beyond the manifesto, the need arose to develop a tool for training, reflection, and knowledge sharing on modern anthropology that would take into account the necessity of recasting certain foundations of anthropology, and in particular, the idea of a new universalism. A portion of the group that wrote the manifesto therefore inquired into developing a virtual dictionary of anthropology anchored in modernity. The idea was to use one of the most traditional ways to define the discipline, a dictionary, and to lay it in open to the perspective defined by the current discussions in the manifesto, as well as organizations such as the WCAA. We named the project Anthropen for anthropology and open access, but also pen for writing. The ultimate aim of the dictionary is is to take part of a critical elaboration of knowledge on societies and cultures. Anthropen will be the first French virtual anthropological dictionary open to a multilingual perspective. It is intended to be firmly rooted in today's world by offering the possibilities to revisit the terms of classical anthropology and to compare them with the meanings that are permanently emerging from new fieldwork and new questions. Anthropen seeks to problematize, update, and even reinvent the discipline's vocabulary. It will also remain open to vocabulary that is in constant redefinition, and of course, to word anthropologies. Anthropen is therefore as a French language platform where international specialists from various intellectual and theoretical backgrounds, including word anthropologies, are invited to elaborate entries based on prior commentary and critical readings. The entries will also be made available in the original language in which they were written, for instance, Ethnoscape. Certain entries may also enter in the untranslatable. In the short time, Anthropen's ambition is to expand its platform to allow information, to allow information exchanges, discussions, and debates around entries that are put into circulation by the dictionary. The tool also offers possibilities such as including film or photographies, features, and we hope pedagogical video clips. Invitations will be sent out in September of 2013, and we hope to begin publication on the web in 2015. My conclusion. Yes, we have the team here. My intent has been to briefly present a series of experience by a group of anthropologists who, in their own way, are participants in the movement of word anthropologies. Considering the fact that this group was formed on the margins of national associations and was a still emerging group, it could not directly join the WCAA. The question of language also was and remains an issue for scientific communications, which for us is translated in the discomfort of a dual hegemony, Anglo-Saxon and Franco-French. It appeared necessary from the outside to establish our own conversation before joining broader circles such as the session we are holding today. We hope to be able to make a stronger contribution to WCAA debates in the future. The legitimacy of the WCAA movement is gaining increased interest, but above all, over and beyond the linking together of non-hegemonic anthropologies, what is needed is to take on the challenge of recasting universalism and perhaps even recasting the discipline from the standpoint of heteroglossic and multi-situated universalism. We must clear the air of the hegemonies that are shrinking the horizons and possibilities of our science. It is rare for anthropologists to take on this task, and I think we need to go beyond the idea of acknowledging national anthropologies. Of course, it is necessary, but of course, we must continue to open doors, but I am not sure that the logic of association alone and in itself is the most effective and the most convincing way forward. National anthropologists will only be able to combat the hegemonies on the major hegemonies centers of the discipline production by showing that the power to define and recast world anthropologies is not only a matter of organization and strength, what is very important, eh, but above all, an epistemological question that holds the key to this discipline's future. If universalism from the Western standpoint is no longer meaningful, it becomes necessary to show which universalism could and should be beyond any national corporatism and in several languages, including, of course, English. The Lausanne Manifesto and Anthropen projects are steps in this direction. Thank you.
Our second speaker is Susan Narotzky of the Universitat de Barcelona. Her paper's title is Occupy Scholarship, Thinking from the Peripheries 10 Years After World Anthropology Network. So, okay.
So, can I use this one or do I have to?
So thank you all for being here at this very early hour of the morning. I want to first of all thank the organizers of the conference and the IUAES for hosting this roundtable and having made possible the interaction and collaboration of anthropologists from all over the world during this very, very fruitful week. I have attended many anthropological conferences, and this one is unique because of its because it seems to me that its aim is to expand communities of thought, and I think this is very, very important. These interaction and collaborations of anthropologists from all over the world is central. So my first thought is that we need institutions such as the IUAES, and we need it to keep growing and pushing us towards international collaboration. I think the enhanced structure of the commissions of the IUAES goes in the right direction, and I hope that they will keep on growing and becoming central to these anthropological conversations that we want to have. So institutions are facilitators. They enable certain things to happen, but they have also their drawbacks. The sheer energy needed to make them work and sustain their structure detracts often from the energy needed to pursue the original aims that were its objectives. The World Anthropologies Network, Red de Antropologías Mundiales, was originally a very simple thing. Various anthropologists from different parts of Latin America initially, mostly, even if some of these anthropologists were based in the US, who knew each other and wanted to supersede the Anglo-American hegemony in the production of anthropological knowledge, started networking and interacting at various venues, with workshops, informal meetings, etc. One of these venues was the International Wenner Grand Symposium organized by Arturo Escobar and Gustavo Lins Ribeiro that we are commemorating today with this roundtable. The objective of this symposium was first to foreground other anthropological traditions and make them aware of each other, that is, to give them value in the eyes of one another. And second, to be aware of other knowledge communities, non-academic, local, vernacular, etc., that may speak to anthropological issues and to anthropological theory. I also want to thank here the Wenner Grand Foundation for being an institution that sponsors this international collaboration of anthropologies worldwide. So, but what I want to highlight about this first network of anthropologies that wanted to supersede the Anglo-American hegemony is that this was centrally a political project, seeking equality among the various communities that were de facto involved in producing anthropological knowledge. So 10 years later, we can draw a balance of the achievements and the long way that we still have to go. We have several institutions, basically the IUAES, who is now being revitalized, and we also have the WCAA, which is an institution connecting different anthropological associations around the world. And these institutions are useful, and they produce different experiments and different forms of collaboration in innovative ways. For example, we have the WCAA has this journal Déjà Lu, who reprints articles from the different journals of the associations. And we also have, for example, an experiment that we are going to be launching in the fall, which is the collaboration of four anthropological associations, the Brazilian, the American, the European, and the Canadian Association, in a webinar, which seeks to break the language hegemony in anthropological knowledge sharing on the one hand, but it also seeks to center on the language issue in general in anthropology. And I will get back to the language issue in a minute. So we are better connected institutionally, but also individually. So these large forums help us to know each other, know what we do, and that's always productive of collaboration. But beyond connectivity, the question I want to raise is, have the power centers of knowledge production really changed? And I doubt it. I think this lack of transformation of the centers of anthropological knowledge production has a lot to do with the language issue. And we know English is undoubtedly the language of international communication, and we have seen these, we have experienced it during all these days, and the sessions we have attended only could have been attended by such a large number of different language speakers with a common language to communicate in. So in this sense, it's very useful to have a common instrument to communicate in our meetings and in our collaborations. But language also acts as a gatekeeper, and it is an obstacle for publication in the major international journals of reference for those that are not native to it, even when they are fluent. Most journals do not accept draft manuscripts in the original language for review, and a few of them do, and are an example to be followed, and Current Anthropology, for example, is one of these journals, but there are others who also are trying to follow this lead. In any case, writing in a language one does not think in conditions expression in a very, very serious way that only the people who have to do this repeatedly know. And this is a very serious issue that all the Anglo-American speakers do not really perceive sufficiently enough. And I think these meetings today, I mean this week, have been also an expression of these differences, of how this hegemony of the language creates differences, and differences in the way one can really make things come through to the audience, no? And also there is a very material issue, which is that scholars who do not write in English and want their articles and papers or ideas to be published in these reference journals have to translate these articles. And this is a cost. Is a cost in the expression of the meaning, because traduttore, traditore, no, we know that. But it is also a cost in money. I mean, you have to pay the translators. And in many of these anthropologists with these languages who write in different languages are not funded and do not have the possibilities and the means to get these translations. So what we see here is a hugely differentiating factor in the production of anthropological knowledge. And I really want to point that. And this has not been resolved at all by any of these associations and institutions. But language is also the actual way in which a paper or a research proposal is written, and in which a paper or a proposal has to be convincing for the reviewers and the funders. And we know that we have workshops on how to write a research proposal or how to write an article for publication. These workshops proliferate all over the US campuses and meetings and also in international meetings. But what they do is that they transfer, they are creating an hegemonic American way, so to speak, of writing proposals and articles. So what's interesting here is that this is homogenizing in a very wide manner the way we think and the way we package our thoughts for the consumption of our colleagues, no? And this is not innocuous, I think. These workshops are helpful in as much as it is the hegemonic model, and we need to operate within this model. So, thank you for the workshops, but on the other hand, it is not devoid of political meaning and and knowledge-producing consequences, because homogenization reinforces gatekeeping and hinders creativity and innovative thinking. This is my view of this. I think difference is necessary. I think eliminating difference is dangerous. It impoverishes the field of knowledge. It reinforces established ideas at the center while excluding innovative or different ideas that thrive at the margins. This is often justified on the grounds of quality, but I think it is not mainly a matter of quality. I think it is a matter of cultural, scholarly hegemony, a matter of power. And breaking up that hegemony was the aim of the original World Anthropologies Network, Red de Antropologías Mundiales, and I think we still have a long way to go. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Susana. Our next speaker is Dr. Gordon Mathews, the Chinese University of Hong Kong. The title is World Anthropologies and the Audit Culture, WCAA, SCCAI, and Some Possible Anthropological Futures. Gordon?
The fact that the world has multiple anthropologies has become increasingly recognized over the past decade. There is a greater awareness that anthropology is not only a Western, Eurocentric, Euro-American endeavor, but a global endeavor, and a greater understanding of the various kinds of anthropology practiced around the world. One sign of this is the growing number of publications discussing world anthropologies. There have been a dozen or more books written or edited over the past 15 years that explore different aspects of global anthropologies, often to considerable response, discussion, and acclaim. Another sign is the growing prominence of the World Council of Anthropological Organizations and of the International Union of Anthropological and Ethnological Sciences. IUAES, after a brief period of eclipse, has really come out strong. WCA is too, and globally, in the global anthropological world, these organizations have become much more prominent in recent years. A third sign of this change is that most major Anglo-American anthropological publications have in the past few years added international anthropologists to their editorial boards. Anthropologists not based in the United States or United Kingdom, but all around the world. The major reason why this greater awareness of global anthropology is taking place is technological. When I left graduate school 20 years ago, moving from Cornell University in the United States through a postdoc to a teaching position in Hong Kong, I was initially warned by well-meaning American professors that being overseas could drastically curtail my career since I would be out of touch. Yeah, I know, it's funny to me too, but that's what they said. But of course, shortly thereafter, the internet and email fully emerged, and global communication was transformed. By 2003, I was editing a book with chapter writers from several continents whom I had never met, a process made easy by email attachments, but all but unimaginable 10 years earlier. Today, open access in its various forms is a major new area of debate in the scholarly world, whose outcomes remain to be seen. But it seems indubitable that scholarly knowledge in anthropology has become far more globally accessible than it was 10 years ago, with libraries' massive collections of volumes increasingly being replaced by lone terminals' internet connections. This represents a very significant leveling of the playing field of global anthropology. Anthropologists in many areas of the developing world can know global anthropology in a way that would have been inconceivable a decade ago. I can see this directly in terms of mainland Chinese students at rural universities. 15 years ago, when we in Hong Kong interviewed them for admission to our graduate program, few would know anything about anthropology after Radcliffe Brown or Fei Xiaotong. Today, they know about contemporary global theories and issues in anthropology, in large part because so much is available with just a few mouse clicks for free. anyone, or at least anyone who knows English, and I refer to my last papers making their excellent points on language, can participate in world conversations. And with translation services getting better, language too may, bit by bit, become less of an impediment. Of course, paywalls surrounding much anthropological literature continue to exclude many students and scholars, not privileged enough to have access, particularly those in the developing world whose libraries cannot afford them. Nonetheless, it seems clear that much more anthropology is freely available in the world now than in the recent past, thanks to the internet. A second reason why this shift towards global anthropology is taking place is economic. To put the matter too crudely, anthropology in a given country follows at a certain distance that country's GDP and per capita income. Anthropology is a luxury. Rich countries can afford anthropology, and particularly an anthropology beyond one's own country's borders. Poor countries can't. Throughout much of the 20th century, American, Western Europeans, and Japanese anthropologists traveled the globe to do their fieldwork, while most countries in the world practiced anthropology only within their own borders, lacking the financial means to go elsewhere. This largely continues to be the case at the moment for most countries' anthropologies. Chinese and Indian anthropologies, to name just a few of the world's biggest, are primarily involved in studying different ethnic groups in one's own country, but perhaps not for much longer. Today, an increasing number of countries throughout the world are beginning to practice an anthropology beyond their borders. Anthropology is increasingly no longer a matter of a few Western countries conducting ethnography on their former colonies and other poorer societies, but more and more of the world investigating more and more of the world. This is a slow process taking place over decades, but it is indeed happening. I've seen this change in my own professional life. At first, when I went to work in Hong Kong, I was sometimes told, "I know of a job in the US you might want to apply for," with my interlocutor assuming that I was overseas simply because I couldn't find a job in the US. Then, within a few years, the comment became, "I know why you're in Hong Kong, it's only for the money." Which isn't that good, but anyway. Today, the conversation has again shifted, with colleagues in the US saying things like, "Universities in America have stopped hiring anthropologists. Do you think I might be able to get a job in Hong Kong?" Indeed, at present, as academic positions in anthropology are diminishing at American and Western European universities, with newly minted PhDs increasingly unable to find jobs, the situation is better elsewhere in the world, particularly in East Asia. Again, anthropology follows economics. Economics may shift, as we all know, but current trends point to an increasing diminishment of Anglo-American anthropology, with a shift of gravity towards Asia and elsewhere. Now, the factors I've just discussed point to a significantly expanded anthropological future than that which we have seen over the past century. Technology levels the playing field of world anthropologies. Economics shifts the balance of that playing field. These two trends point to the growing emergence of a global anthropology. However, the same factors of globalization that are leading to a leveling and shifting of the playing field are also leading to a calcifying of the playing field. As numerous critics have discussed, a major factor shaping universities worldwide has been their increasing awareness of global competition. This has come about in conjunction with the neoliberalization of university management initiated by Margaret Thatcher and invading many of the world's universities since that time, leading to the increasing importance of administrators over professors. World university ranking schemes, such as those of the Times Education Supplement, had become increasingly influential, and university administrators in many societies based their professional lives on somehow enabling their institutions to rise a few places in these rankings. These rankings are based on a wide variety of factors, with some, such as the reputation of an institution, being intangible. But one key factor is the publication output of an institution's professors. This output is typically measured by the quality of the journals that professors publish in, a quality measured in the social sciences by such markers as the Social Science Citation Index. The necessity of such markers is explained by administrators as follows. Those outside a given discipline cannot judge the quality of output in that discipline by actually reading its work. The only way that output can be measured across disciplines is by having a common mode of measurement, such as the Social Science Citation Index. The fact that many anthropologists publish books and chapters in edited books and may not rely on journals as their primary mode of knowledge dissemination is beside the point in administrators' arguments. Since book impacts cannot be so easily measured, journals become all important, distorting anthropology. As the editor of a journal, Asian Anthropology, I am constantly asked by potential contributors in China, Japan, and India, and elsewhere, whether it is in the Social Science Citation Index. If it is, it counts. If it is not, then it does not count. And it is not in SSCI, so it does not yet count. To anthropologists in these societies and many other societies, the SSCI is the single indicator of worth, as deemed by department chairs and the administrators who pressure and oversee these chairs. With SSCI publication, a given scholar may obtain financial rewards and promotion. Without it, you may lose your job. The problem with the Social Science Citation Index and other such measures is that they're so heavily tilted towards Anglo-American publications. This does not mean that SSCI is practicing a conscious bias towards Anglo-American publications. There's a fairly rigorous and more or less objective set of criteria for inclusion in SSCI, and it's weird reading it over because one criteria, they clearly favor English language. And you guys who gave earlier papers are absolutely right, that is a bias. On the other hand, they want international editorial boards. Primarily, they're looking at citation impact factor and a number of other factors. In any case, the effect is to favor Anglo-American and European publications. Of 81 journals listed by SSCI under the category of anthropology, 36 have publishers based in the United States, 19 have publishers based in the United Kingdom, 55 out of 81, a bit more than two-thirds of the total. Another 10 are based in France, Germany, and the Netherlands, and 3 are from Australia. All countries heavily influenced by Anglo-American anthropology. 76 out of 81 total publications, 94% of the total, come from the United States, the United Kingdom, Western or Middle Europe, or Australia and New Zealand. Of the remainder, there are 2 Indian anthropological journals on the list, 2 from Latin America, 1 from Africa, South Africa, and none from China, from Japan, or from Korea. Now, this survey is complicated by the fact that it's based on the country of the publisher, which doesn't always reflect the editorial focus of a journal, and also by the fact that archaeology and physical anthropology journals are merged with sociocultural anthropology journals, so it's a little bit different to disentangle. Also, there's some sociological journals in there. But the journals it lists are not simply in English, but are multilingual. This clearly represents a broad listing of the world's most prestigious journals related to anthropology. And, as we've just seen, it is an overwhelmingly Anglo-American and Western European list of journals. If anthropologists from most societies across the globe seek to publish in a fully recognized journal, they cannot publish at home. Now, if anthropology were a hard science, then this situation would not be quite so alarming, in that while the findings of engineers, cardiac specialists, and particle physicists are culturally shaped, the findings of such a scientist in New Delhi will generally not be substantively different from one in Tokyo or New York. Since the disciplines are largely global and singular, we typically do not speak of Indian and Japanese and American variants of physics or medicine or engineering, although some anthropologists do, then the fact of a single set of prestigious global journals would hardly be a cause for alarm. But anthropology is not singular. There are multiple anthropologies across the globe, and Mexican anthropology at present has substantially different topics and concerns than does Chinese anthropology or American anthropology. Despite this fact, anthropologists from societies around the globe may have little choice but to publish in Anglo-American journals that have little or no interest in the anthropology of their home societies. They are, in effect, forced to become Anglo-American in their anthropological concerns. Anthropology has long since transcended Morgan and Tyler intellectually in their late 19th century assertion that Western Europe and the United States represented the pinnacle of civilization. But institutionally, this is exactly what's been happening. Morgan and Tyler and their world are being recreated. The West is best. We thus see two opposing currents shaping contemporary anthropology. One current moving towards the globalization of anthropology, and the other towards the Anglo-Americanization of anthropology. Which of these will win out? I see it as inevitable that intellectually anthropology will move towards greater and greater globalization, and I think this will be the best thing that's ever happened to the discipline. Institutionally, however, the obverse seems inevitable. Universities everywhere are becoming managerialized, and this means that because of the processes of measurement of journal output and other outputs that I've discussed, anthropology will, to some extent, be forced to become more Western-centric and Anglo-American-centric. However, we can do something to solve this problem. Journals' inclusion and ranking within the Social Science Citation Index and other indexes like it are determined in part by matters such as impact factor. How much are articles in a given journal cited? The Social Science Citation Index is thus not an unchanging wall, but is something that we ourselves create through our collective citations. Thus far in history, the majority of anthropologists have been Western or Western trained. Unsurprisingly, they have tended to cite Western theorists and ethnographers. But now that we're entering an era of the increasing influence of multiple global anthropologies, the solution to the problem seems clear. Cite your own anthropological authors. Don't rely on Western theorists as the basis of your writing. This may be difficult to do. As a young Hong Kong ethnographer told me a few years ago, as she said, I know how to get an article accepted by a Western publication. I just quote Bourdieu. Now, today, she probably should have said Agamben. But the point is that there is indeed a herd mentality among peripheral anthropologists, circling as satellites around Western anthropologies and quoting Western dominant intellectual figures as a legitimating device. And this needs to be transcended. Initially, anthropologists who do try to transcend this, who buck this trend, may suffer from rejection. But eventually, given what I think will be Western anthropology's increasingly shaky self-confidence, the tide will turn if non-Western anthropologists are willing to take up this challenge. This challenge will be difficult because it can't simply involve non-Anglo-American anthropologies turning their back on Anglo-American anthropologies. Given current realities, that would be suicidal as well as stupid. But it can more fully engage Anglo-American anthropologies with the intellectual resources of other anthropologies in such a way that Anglo-American anthropologies will have to accept a broader basis for what anthropology as a discipline consists of. And if this can take place, the winner will not simply be one faction of anthropology, Anglo-American or otherwise, but all the world's anthropologies. In this way, the conflict between the globalization of anthropology and the Anglo-Americanization of anthropology, the conflict of symbolic acronyms between WCAA, IUAES on the one hand, and SSCI on the other, can be resolved. This may be a long, slow process, but if anthropology is to survive as a discipline rather than as an historical relic, it is absolutely necessary and inevitable. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon. Now, fourth paper will be presented by Michal Buchowski of the University of Poznan. The title of the paper is Hybridity and Contact Zones as a Hope for Cosmopolitan Anthropology.
Well, Well, I should wear Balotelli's t-shirt or jersey from the game when he played for Manchester City. I mean, why it's always me? Okay, it's not that bad. Well, thank you very much. I don't know what to say after what was already has been said. I should simply shut up and we could go for the closing ceremony, but this ritual has to be completed. I will do my presentation in two steps. First, I will try to shed light on the historic importance of world anthropologist movement, as I call it, and then I will say a little bit what can be done now. Let me start with the quotation. Pertinent to the problem I want to present. And, well, I am probably the only one person who was not educated also at both levels, at American or English university. So, and I am from Europe, but Europe is also divided. A very good Western anthropologist working in the Alpine region wrote that a contemporary ethnographer from France and England or America, France, England, and America, carrying the very latest lightweight intellectual machine gun in his pack, may be suddenly confronted by a Taylorian or Fraserian professor appearing like a Japanese corporal from the jungle to wage a battle on he knows is still on. Until recently, representatives of ethnology in continental Europe were treated as living skeleton of the past. Fabian's notion of allochronies fully applies here. European ethnographers were co-evil, but placed in the past. Ethnologies were, we could say, backward anthropologies. Susana Narotzky, sitting here, you know her probably, drew similar conclusion when discussing the relationship between the local and external scholars in Spain. More recently, the same phenomena could be witnessed in Eastern Europe. This style, or hopefully past period in anthropological thinking of Anglo-American and French scholars, Catherine Verdery calls them shortly franglus anthropologists, toward other anthropologists can be called panoptical. A lack of interest in local scholarly production was a salient feature of this approach. Already in 1968, a Hungarian scholar, Thomas Hofer, observed in Current Anthropology that anthropologists devote... There is no... So I have to just read it. Sorry, I missed it. Anthropologists devote much attention to specialists who guard traditional knowledge within a given society. However, as far as I know, European national ethnographers have not yet been studied as equivalent figures in their own society, unquote. This Franglus-style anthropology expanded to new territories, and the same concept of backward indigenous scholarship has traveled across the globe. Simultaneously, those anthropologists who represented this anthropological correctness, represented this mainstream or dominant tradition were, or have been, functioning as guardians of the anthropological correctness, so to say. In other words, in words of Restrepo and Escobar, dominant anthropologists, and I quote, constituted themselves as a set of differentiating interventions of what counts as anthropology and who an anthropologist is, unquote. Neither were the so-called self-reflexivity concerned with the local anthropological knowledge. So we had this self-reflexivity movements and they were not taking this local knowledge into account. First, a critique of anthropological involvement in the colonial project in the 1960s and 1970s, Delheims, Diamond, and others, was mainly focused on the collective subject, that is, the relationship between Western anthropologies and studied societies. Second, postmodern self-reflexivity of the late 1970s and 80s addressed the relation between the Western anthropologists and the individual subjects of her studies and could be illustrated in by the well-known and used before by greater than myself picture of Las Meninas, or labeled as Velasquezian. Theoretical insights produced beyond the English, French, or sometimes German academia, however, even when they were focused on local studies, were not taken into consideration in none of the processes of enriching the discipline. They simply did not exist in Western imagination. What kind of theory can be produced in Mongolia? Word anthropologist movement can be seen as the next step in the evolution of word anthropology. I want to emphasize its two characteristics. A lot has been said, so just two. First, the very idea of the movement was put forward by scholars trained in the West, mostly in the US, several of them from Latin America, it was mentioned. In a sense, the history of the movement replicated a trajectory of many other emancipatory movements, raising consciousness and self-organization. Second, the word anthropologist movement differs a lot from the classical post-colonial critique and subaltern studies. Celebrated representatives of the latter, usually coming from South Asia and Africa, Spivak, Chakrabarty, Bembe, were co-opted both intellectually and institutionally in the Western academia. Their case could be called an encompassment and illustrated by the simple graphic that you just see. Word anthropologists differs also from the decolonizing perspective represented by, for instance, Minoglio or Grossvogel, and claiming radical decolonization of knowledge by total rejection of epistemological Eurocentrism, in particular the Kantian dualism. Word anthropologist perspective has been less radical, more productive, and pragmatic. All its principal ideas could be found in the word anthropologist volume published 7 years ago, which I won't repeat now, of course. Enough is to say that the movement doesn't repudiate the Western episteme as such, nor anthropological ideas and practices invented in the West. It merely, resists the domination of one, or at best, few intellectual traditions and their hegemonic position. In several respects, the main goal or mission of the word anthropologist movement remains unchanged. At the same time, it has reached a point at which some its aims need to be re-emphasized, while some new incentives, both intellectual and pragmatic, are necessary or even urgent. Let me start with the first one, that is intellectual. Attention paid to the existing inequalities has never been the only goal of word anthropologists. Dividing word into center and periphery, in particular the global north and south, as many decolonizers do, essentializes and ossifies the map of anthropological traditions by painting it white and black. It leaves various anthropological regions in gray areas, like, for instance, Eastern Europe, or places many of anthropologists worldwide out of the picture in a cognitive, scientific, and or political limbo. Several strategies of putting such traditions in contact, creating hybrid and creative contact zones, can be distinguished and visualized. Linking even two of them is potentially productive. As simple as it may seem, it is often neglected in practice. After all, complaints about methodological nationalism are common. Convergence cannot be reduced to information exchange, but should assume some sort of merging the horizons. Obviously, this innovative potential increases when more traditions interact. The point I want to make in presenting this figure diagram is that traditions involved may represent different research or even conceptual paradigms, use different vocabulary and languages, in a philosophical sense of the term, of course. Word anthropologies should comprise a system of knowledge exchange resembling Hall of Mirrors, in which we all look at each other and at the same time can see ourselves, self-reflexivity in its fullest form. It is definitely a big step forward in relation to Las Meninas' image. It's a bit more postmodern. So we look. A complementary and ultimate form of that sort of exchange enables a constant flow of anthropological knowledge. One should read it as a de-essentialized, borderless, decentralized, non-ethnocentric, and non-hegemonic flow of ideas, concepts, languages, and theories that constantly fertilize our thinking. So far, so good. But how can we reconceptualize and justify this standpoint? Why should we encourage or expect from anthropologists representing dominant traditions to get interest in this democratic, although always critical, flow of knowledge? Why should they resign from their privileged position? Arguments are ethical and cognitive at the same time. Let me refer to Theodor Adorno, who wrote that the danger of judging intellectual phenomena in a subsumptive, uninformed, and administrative manner and assimilating them into the prevailing constellations of power, which the intellect ought to expose, did not stop. I would like to add that such attitude is simply vicious, arrogant, and against the anthropological ethos. Judith Butler argues that moral experience has to do with self-transformation by a form of knowledge that is foreign to one's own. In other words, one cannot be critical and ethical if one is not willing to cross confines of his or her conceptual paradigms. Crossing them is the fulfillment of anthropology's mission. Reaching out to other forms of knowledge is not only an intellectual challenge for all of us, but our moral duty. In our globalized world, we all face global problems which cannot be solved from any particular perspective. Unveiling the ways in which global capital transforms different social groups, disposes them, and often put their lives at risk requires our deep and constant cooperation. Such cosmopolitan and simultaneously locally rooted anthropology has a potential of showing how all human relations worldwide are, and I cite Gupta and Ferguson, traversed by economic and political relations of inequality and are part and parcel of global system of domination. In our attempts to counter the economic and political, as well as intellectual hegemony, marginalized and provincial anthropologies, the so-called provincial anthropologies, achievement has to be made visible and lively involved in global anthropological enterprise. Hence, the authorship of thematic and regional journals and edited books should be as international as possible and involve local scholars working on a given topic. Translation is another example. So far, the collaboration between the so-called peripheral and central anthropologists has prevailed. Training and brain draining have gone in the opposite direction. Bi- and multilateral communication should be diversifying, and links between different peripheries, in inverted commas, that is, anthropologists, for instance, anthropologists from East and South, ought to be promoted. Such relations cannot be reduced to the axis, the West and the rest. The IUAES Congress provides a platform for international exchange of ideas of scholars coming from all corners of the world. It is always essential to remember to draw as much as possible from these diverse perspectives and experience. Cooperation between subaltern anthropologies remains high priority of WCAA. A struggle for world anthropologies is never done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michal.
Our next speaker is Gustavo Ribeiro. The paper's title is Rethinking World Anthropologies.
Thank you, Junji. This year is the 10th anniversary of the Werner Grund Foundation's International Symposium, World Anthropologies, Transformations of the Disciplines Within Systems of Power. This paper is dedicated to the colleagues who participated in that meeting in 2003, and also to the many others that are members of the World Anthropologies Network and who have cooperated to create more diverse and critical exchanges among anthropologists on a global level. Since they are too many, I ask them to excuse me if I mention only the names of Arturo Escobar, Eduardo Restrepo, Marisol de la Cadena, and Susana Narotzky, without whose leadership, energy, and imagination the World Anthropologies movement would have never been possible. World anthropologies are a political and theoretical perspective that aims at, one, pluralizing the history of anthropology, two, spreading the awareness that the discipline is made up of many different perspectives according to its practitioners' loci of enunciation, three, propitiating the emergence of cosmopolitan anthropological practices that create a less Eurocentric discipline dominated by a few hegemonic centers in the North Atlantic. The World Anthropologies movement is influenced by the notion that there is a geopolitics of knowledge, historically related to the unequal power distribution within the world system of anthropological production. World anthropologies assume that anthropologists value diversity as a means of improving understanding and creativity, that it's possible to enhance cross-fertilization if anthropologists take advantage of the heterodox opportunities opened by globalization processes of the late 20th century and the early 21st century. It also assumes that there is a need to avoid what French anthropologist Benoît de l'Estoile called the gravitational power of hegemonic internationalization and reach a heteroglossic plateau in order to go beyond the monotony of an academic universe dominated by Anglo-American perspectives and agendas. Finally, the World Anthropologies movement also assumes that universality as a notion dominated by a Eurocentric vision of epistemological achievements is to be left behind in favor of diversality. I'm going to make a very brief history of the World Anthropologies. World Anthropologies can be seen as a part of a set of events and conceptions that have an episodic history represented by symposia, the publication of different books and articles in the last 6 decades. However, only in the 2000s, in view of the characteristics of the current moment of increased globalization, such as global online communication that Gordon mentioned here, for instance, the appearance of the World Anthropologies Network made this trend visible enough to merit ample discussion as a means of transforming the state of the art of anthropological knowledge. The organization of a network on the internet, the fact that most of its members are professionals working outside the United States, some are non-American working in the United States, the critical approach to the dominance of hegemonic anthropologies, and the congealment of its programmatic narratives into new institutional initiatives are features that distinguish this movement's impacts. Although to some extent unknowingly, the World Anthropologies Project is heir to several previous cosmopolitan interventions in the history of the discipline, several of them presented by Leslie Aiello in her inaugural lecture, so I don't have to repeat them here. I just want to recall that the Wenner-Gren Foundation was founded by a Hungarian filmmaker and financially backed by a global Swedish tycoon. Notice their nationalities. Both men were European cosmopolitans in their own rights. Indeed, the Wenner-Gren Foundation, since the early 1950s, has been present in many important moments for the internationalization of the discipline. The founding of the World Council of Anthropological Associations in Brazil in 2004, and the 2006 book World Anthropologies, edited by Arturo Escobar and myself, are but recent examples of the Wenner-Gren Foundation's aid, of how the Wenner-Gren Foundation's aid has been strategic to these endeavors. This book, by the way, has also been published in Spanish, in Colombia and Mexico, and in Portuguese in Brazil. There are other crucial initiatives that developed over time outside of the United States, pointing out to the existence of what could be called complementary cosmopolitan projects. The most outstanding one was the creation in 1934 of this institution, the International Union of Anthropological and Ethnological Sciences, an example of the active participation of British colleagues in the creation of international structures for the discipline. On the conceptual front, it is impossible not to mention a 1972 book edited by an Egyptian anthropologist called Hossein Fahim, and also the 1982 volume of the Swedish journal Ethnos, edited by Thomas Gerholm and Ulf Hanets. Other important contributions were made by Mexican anthropologist Esteban Krotz, who wrote an influential piece on anthropologies of the South, and by that was published in 1997, and by Brazilian anthropologist Roberto Cardoso de Oliveira, that published a piece in 1999, exploring the ideas of peripheral and central anthropologies. Japanese anthropologist Takamiku Ayama, in 2004, further elaborated the notion of a world system of anthropological production. These predecessors certainly prepared the ground for the critical instance that was to be fully developed by the World Anthropologies Project. Finally, in the past 20 years, other important books were published. They either aimed at portraying anthropology's diversity, such as the book Organized, edited by De L'Estoile, Neyburg, and Sigo in 2002, the book edited by Boscovich in 2008, or discussing regional or national anthropological traditions, such as the books edited by Vina Das in 2003, Deshpande, Uberoy, and Sunda in 2008, Intarwangi, Mills, and Babiker in 2006, Miceli in 1995, Grinson, Ribeiro, and Seman in 2004, Ribeiro and Trajano 2004, Skalnik 2005, Yamashita, Bosco, and Eads 2004, for instance. I should also mention the 2011 Lausanne Manifesto, of which Francine Saillant is one of the authors. These volumes provide other productive entries to further sophisticate the debate on world anthropologies. The larger intellectual environment within which world anthropologies developed in the 2000s also include other previous critiques of anthropology as a discipline, such as Heim's Reinventing Anthropology, published in 1974, and Assad's Anthropology and the Colonial Encounter, published in 1973. But more importantly, the world anthropologist's perspective is a special blend of politicized theoretical debates that include, quote unquote, subaltern studies, cultural studies, post-colonialism, decoloniality of power, multiculturalism, interculturality, post-imperialism, and also a strong sensibility to transnational activism, cosmopolitanism, and the internet as a political tool on the global level. Theories and issues. There are several issues the world anthropology's perspective has tackled with. Some are related to theoretical debates, others are open to historiographic revisionism, and others yet are related to different political positionings. I include among them anthropology as an Eurocentric academic discourse, or anthropology as a universal and plural mode of knowing. The mechanisms of dissemination and reproduction of the discipline on the global and national levels. The existence of centers and peripheries in the academic world. Theoretical dependency or intellectual autonomy. Nativism, the possibility of a universal theory in the social sciences in a post-identity politics globalized world. The usage of language in scholarly communication. The existence of different academic styles and epistemologies. These tensions gravitate around the issue of cosmopolitanism versus localism and of the power imbalance among loci of knowledge production. The world anthropology's debate is also related to the valuing of other forms of knowledge beyond the walls of the university system. Regarding the tensions underlying world anthropology's main theoretical and political issues, I want to argue the following. One, when the issue is the inequity in the exchange and dissemination of academic knowledge on the global level, what is at stake is what Luiz Roberto Cardoso de Oliveira, Brazilian anthropologist, called symmetrical comparisons and dialogical partnerships. That is, comparisons and partnerships in which the two or more sides involved are viewed as equivalents and where none of the interlocutors assume a moral paradigmatic or academic superiority. Two, when the issue is the limits of Western epistemology, what is at stake are the parameters and modes that validate different people's capacity of producing knowledge, solving problems, and innovating. The South African anthropologist Mathews, for instance, challenges the universality of the notion of epistemology itself. Three, when the issue is the recognition that anthropology has always been involved with the politics of alterity, what is at stake is the recognition that the discipline is a cosmopolitics and the modes of constructing the universality of discourses on otherness. Four, when the issue is the unequal visibility and power distribution among different anthropological communities, what is at stake is transnational communication and transnational academic politics, a rather complex endeavor, as those of us who are involved in it can testify. In the end, the world anthropology's debate is an exploration of whether there is one anthropology or many, of how the social sciences and the humanities will position themselves in an era of advanced globalization in which the Western university has spread everywhere as a mode of providing higher education, of producing and disseminating knowledge, and has domesticated, if not obliterated, an enormous quantity of other forms of knowledge production and dissemination. Will the discipline be able to explore its own global diversity, or will it surrender to the forces of hegemonic globalization? Perhaps because anthropologists have long developed approach to interpret the world as a whole made up of universals and particulars, they were ready to engage with the world anthropology's agenda. A necessity that surely does not stop at our disciplinary borders, as the book commissioned by the International Sociological Association, edited by Sujata Patel and published in 2010, and the World Social Science Report of UNESCO, published in 2010, make clear. These reinforce the idea that world anthropologies are the end result of an awareness enhanced by globalization that the discipline can further advance by promoting and taking advantage of its own international diversity. Now, my final comments. Let me finish by making a brief assessment of these 10 years after the World Anthropologies Symposium. Is the World Anthropologies Project a failure or a success? It's clearly not a failure, otherwise you wouldn't be here. It's clearly not a 100% success. It is true that most of the problems World Anthropologies wanted to tackle are still with us. Do Brazilians read Japanese anthropologists, or Germans read Indian ones? Isn't the canonic history of this discipline still completely Eurocentric? Isn't the publishing hierarchy still the same in spite of some minor changes? What do we do with the linguistic predominance of English and Anglo-American writing styles? Some of these questions were also raised by my colleagues before me. But it's equally true that in several universities in Europe, North America, Latin America, and elsewhere, the debate on world anthropologies was included in theory courses. It is also true that the creation of the World Council of Anthropological Associations and of the Committee on World Anthropologies within the American Anthropological Association, two institutional innovations that derive from the world anthropologies debate, give us hope that the problems of academic hegemony concerning the practices of our discipline on a global level finally entered the agenda of anthropologists. What will come out of this is hard to predict. Hegemony is embedded in a web of relations agents and agencies keep. As such, hegemony is constantly regenerating itself and appropriating in its very reproduction the criticisms and challenges it faces. But while reproducing itself in order to keep power imbalances the more stable as possible, hegemony changes and creates spaces for new challenges and contradictions. All this means that the search for equality within whatever social universe is an endless political struggle. The World Anthropologist Project is no exception to this. Thank you.
Thank you, Gustavo. Now our final presenter is Sanjay Seth. The title of the paper, Once Was Blind, But Now I Can See. Once Was Blind, But Now Can See, Modernity and the Social Sciences.
I'll begin with a confession. I'm not an anthropologist. It's all the more pleasure to be here, of course. My own intellectual genealogy comes out of subaltern studies and post-colonial theory, but I am interested in questions of the epistemic status of the sort of knowledge that is produced through the human sciences, including the social sciences. And the question of that epistemic status, I think, along with my friend Gustavo, Susana, and the other members of the panel, is intimately connected with political issues. But without further prefatory comments, let me begin. And I'll begin with a couple of anthropological sort of anecdotes just to demonstrate that I'm not wholly illiterate in your discipline. In his Ghosts of War in Vietnam, Hyonik Kwon describes a region of Vietnam abounding with the ghosts of those who met violent deaths away from home. The humans who share their world with these ghosts, and also with gods and other deities, and with the spirits of their dead ancestors, are part of an eminently modern society characterized by extensive market relations and many of the other appurtenances and symbols of modernity. And the ghosts themselves are not remnants of a time long past, because a large number of them are the ghosts of the war dead, both American and Vietnamese. Those who attend to the needs of ghosts by making offerings of food and drink, votive money, clothing, and sometimes even a bicycle or a Honda, make their offerings irrespective of the nationality of these spectral figures. Whatever their nationality or politics, ghosts have a right to exist in the social world of the living, and the rituals and offerings the living make are, writes Kwon, part of a constant negotiation over social and ecological space with this ontologically given, socially distinct group of beings. My second anecdote or example concerns the distinction between nature and society, a distinction which is fundamental and axiomatic for many societies, including our own, but which anthropologists tell us is not so for others. According to Philippe Descola, the Shua people of the Upper Amazon do not share our antinomy between two closed and irremediably opposed worlds, the cultural world of human society and the natural world of animal society. Instead, they confer the attributes of social life on plants and animals, regarding these as subjects rather than objects. Now, when we, as scholars of the human sciences, seek to explain and understand such phenomena, we usually engage in a form of conceptual translation. Confronted by those who believe in gods, spirits, and ghosts, we treat these as manifestations of some other intelligible phenomenon. We then explain these beliefs as self-estrangement if we are Marxists, or as in some way necessary to the representation of social unity if we are followers of Durkheim, or in terms of some functional requirement if we are functionalists. And we do this despite the fact that ghosts, spirits, and dead ancestors are ontological phenomena for those whom we are seeking to understand, not allegorical or metaphorical ones. Their existence, for those whom we are studying, does not depend upon whether or not they are believed in. And when we confront those who do not distinguish nature from society, we smile indulgently, for we know that we are in the presence of those for whom the world is still not disenchanted, for whom, mistakenly, if charmingly, the world as a whole, including nature, is still pregnant with meaning and purpose. And we usually try and find a socio-cultural explanation for their confusions that would render these comprehensible. Or if we're socio-biologists, we seek a natural explanation in the form of environmental or genetic constraints. In either case, the mode of our explanation presupposes a distinction between nature and society, the very distinction which the subjects of our study cannot conceive of or deny. In both the cases of the Shua and the Vietnamese studied by Kwon, the understandings that the human sciences make available to us, varied as these might be, all rely upon translating the explanations and self-understandings of those whom we are seeking to understand into our own terms. Not just translating, but also overriding. For we assume that our descriptions and explanations offer an understanding superior to their own. Of course, it's often thought to be a hallmark of the rigor of social scientific explanations that they get behind or under the self-understandings of agents to causes and conditions which are unavailable to social actors. But note that when we apply the social sciences to our own understandings, when we invoke hidden or underlying causes to explain features of our own culture, they are ones that are part of our conceptual universe. We may assent or deny if told that our erotic relations are connected to the workings of our unconscious, but we recognize that sort of explanation because, by and large, the unconscious is part of our world. The sort of explanations we offer in the above examples, the ones with which I began, however, are not always and fully part of their world. do a little thought experiment. It would be as if the Shua people of the Amazon or the Vietnamese of Cam Ranh were to tell us or explain to us that it was our failure to attend to the needs of ghosts and our worship of this malign god of ours, the unconscious, that was the source of our tortuous erotic life. What's at issue, in other words, is not whether we have to take the self-understandings of our subjects at face value. We clearly don't have to do so, and the cosmologies and explanations of other people also regularly invoke hidden factors as explanations. What's at issue, rather, is whether the categories invoked in social science explanations are superior to those that they translate. Where do our categories come from? Like all knowledges, they have a source in a particular time and place. The place is Europe, the time is the early modern period. As modern knowledge emerged and came to be defined through a critique of scholastic, other medieval and Renaissance knowledges, all of these were condemned for confusing humans with their world, for attributing to the world a meaning and purpose which in fact belongs to us and which we have projected onto the world. One of the defining features of modern knowledge then was that it presumed a sharp distinction between subject and object, knower and known. It further assumed that the world was divided between a disenchanted nature, which was to be understood in terms of laws and regularities, and a newly discovered object called society, which was a realm of meanings, purposes and ends. It also reversed the order between gods and men, presuming that gods were to be explained in terms of men rather than men in terms of gods. Once novel and engaged in a battle with other knowledges, this knowledge today is triumphant. Moreover, it has become global. It has not only superseded the pre-modern knowledges of Europe, but also the autochthonous knowledges of the non-Western world. Max Weber once wrote that explanations in the social sciences aim to be acknowledged as correct even by a Chinese. The mode of expression is, of course, offensive to modern ears, but what he's talking about is a claim to the universality of the social sciences, a claim which they still make, albeit without, you know, that sort of language. And what's more, that was not just an aspiration. Today they usually are, because the only knowledge which counts as respectable knowledge, whether the site of its production is London or Hanoi or Delhi, is the knowledge produced within the modern human sciences. Other knowledges have been devalued and survive, where they survive at all, as in the cases of the examples with which I began in the quotidian, where they're often subject to the strictures of the post-colonial state, which wags its fingers at its subjects for their superstitions and their lack of modernity. For a long time, then, we've lived with a paradox. Despite their European provenance, the human sciences are presumed to be universal. But in recent decades, doubts and self-questioning have emerged and become recurrent themes. The sort of doubts and self-questionings which Gustavo and others have led in anthropology, but which have occurred in many disciplines. Chakrabarty, for instance, has suggested that the very concepts through which explanations in the human sciences are fashioned have genealogies which go deep into the intellectual and even theological traditions of Europe, and that the analytic categories which the social sciences assume to be universal, including capital, state, individual, civil society, and so on, may not in fact transcend the European history from which they originate. Others have argued that knowledge is connected to power, and that the triumph and global reach of the modern social sciences is a consequence not necessarily of their intellectual superiority, but of colonialism and the force of arms. The contemporary intellectual scene, I suggest, is characterized by an acute consciousness of the historicity of our knowledge, of the fact that it belongs to a time and place. But it's now unaccompanied by any compelling argument, I think, for its superiority to other knowledges. Once we were confident, in David Kolb's words in Critique of Pure Modernity, that modern knowledge was not just another in a sequence of historic constructions, but was rather the unveiling of what had been at the root of these constructions. Today, I would suggest, some of us at least, the attendance of many of you at this session suggests, not in small numbers, some of us are coming to belatedly realise that modernity and modern knowledge are, in fact, just another in a sequence of historic constructions. And that brings me to another point. Once we acknowledge that the categories of modern knowledge are not the truth finally uncovered, but just another in a sequence of historic constructions, we can begin to face up to the fact that they're often inadequate to their non-Western objects. I have to truncate what is a longish paper, and I've been truncating as I go along. So I want to focus on one thing. I want to suggest that the concept of society is a particularly important and revealing example. The discovery of the social is one of the hallmarks of modern thought and the modern social sciences, as their very name betrays. Where others explain, for instance, things with reference to gods and cosmic forces, we moderns not only override these explanations, we typically outflank them by diagnosing their misperceptions as arising out of social causes. For us, society is at once the cause and the locale of explanation, both first mover and substance, in medieval philosophical terms. But following the lead of Castoriadis and others, I want to suggest that society is not something we discovered, but something we created. Keith Michael Baker, historian of the French Revolution, puts it most directly and forcefully. Society is an invention, not a discovery. It is a representation of the world instituted in practice, not simply a brute objective fact. Represented and instituted do not, as I will shortly explain, mean imaginary or fictitious, but they do mean not discovered. Now, if for a moment we entertain the possibility that society is but a particular way of construing and constructing human interdependence rather than an ontological given, then the question arises of how it came to be constructed. In contemporary jargon, what is the constitutive outside of society? What has to be excluded in order to construct this concept reality? The answer is, of course, complex, but I suggest two elements stand out, elements that refer us back to the two examples with which I began: the exclusion or expulsion of gods and of nature. The expulsion of gods and spirits occurs by bringing them under the category of religion, a category that takes the form of a genus divided into different species, Christianity, Islam, etc., etc. But understanding gods and spirits thus is itself a product of a history, and a specifically European and Christian history, as some scholars of religion have come to recognize. This is one in which religion and belief emerge as mutually constitutive categories, making it possible to invent the category religion as the genus of which different religious beliefs are the species. The very category of religion is itself, as one scholar describes it, a Christian theological category, a modern invention which the West, during the last 200 years or so, has exported to the rest of the world. Like many Western exports, it's not always, however, a useful one. It doesn't always travel well. For the use of this category already exorcises the world of gods and ghosts. They've been relocated from the world to our minds, from ontological realities to social products. To use it is already to dismiss the self-understandings of those Vietnamese who share their world with ghosts, or those Hindus who share their world with their numerous gods, for instance. Relatedly, and equally important, society is constructed or constituted by distinguishing it from nature. We know already that this distinction is not made by all peoples. It wasn't always made by Europeans. The historian of science, Lorraine Daston, reminds us that in the medieval West, there were not two categories, the natural and the social, but a host of them, including the supernatural, preternatural, artificial, and unnatural. This opposition, she tells us, the categories of nature and culture conceived in yin-yang complementarity are of relatively recent provenance. They are, I would suggest, as recent as the early modern period, when Hobbes, Hume, and others began to mock the idea that the invocation of purpose and meaning could play any role in understanding a domain of reality that was now to be understood as being characterized by its impersonal and law-like regularities. So what I'm suggesting is that the invention of society involved a reshuffling of categories such that gods and ghosts could no longer be treated as ontological beings, because they were relocated in the human mind and in this new object, society, and nature conversely was expelled from this object. And that's why when we encounter Vietnamese ghosts and the animal and plant subjects of the Shua, we are forced to translate. We cannot take their explanation seriously because their categories are born out of a denial of ours. But following the earlier part of my argument, I'm also suggesting we have no compelling reason to privilege our category of society. It's not a discovery of something that had always been there all along, only waiting for us to emancipate ourselves from superstition, etc., in order to discover it. Rather, it's a fabrication largely peculiar to us moderns. And because it's a fabrication, I'm suggesting that it does not serve well to understand worlds that have been fabricated differently. Now, in using verbs like constitute and fabricate to discuss knowledge, I aim to challenge what is perhaps the most fundamental presumption of modern Western knowledge in the human sciences, namely that knowledge is essentially passive, that knowledge is an act by a subject who mirrors or represents objects. And I want to end by suggesting that knowledge is not only a matter of cognizing a world out there, but that it helps constitute whatever worlds we have. That modern knowledge is not simply the self-apprehension of modernity, but that it's played a critical part in constituting it. Let me explain what I mean through one or two examples. Timothy Mitchell argues that the distinction between real and representation, central to modern ways of apprehending and organizing the world, did not make much sense to the people of colonial Egypt, who neither thought that way nor inhabited a world organized around this distinction. However, as the distinction between the real and representation became the grid organizing collective life in the colonial model, as it came to undergird not only what was taught in schools and universities, but also the spatial layout of the city and the practices of the law court and the office, it assumed a certain reality and now became meaningful in a way that it had not previously been. One more example. Hinduism, itself something of an invented term, was not a matter of beliefs, ever. But as elite Indians sought to meet the civilizational challenge of the West, as they encountered Western disdain, what sort of ridiculous religion is this with its millions of gods and no holy book and no idea, you know, Hindus seem to believe whatever they like. Get two Hindus together and they seem to believe different things. In response to this, some elite Hindus started to reorganize themselves, and in the reformulations of the Brahmo Samaj and the Arya Samaj, the Hinduism of some Indians became a proper religion, one that now fitted the category that had once misdescribed it. They could now answer questions like, what do you believe? They could even say, actually, we're monotheists. All of our numerous gods are the various avatar of a single god, because we're monotheists just like you. Now, if we understand fabricate or construct along these lines, it will also immediately become clear that such fabrications don't work on inert material and a tabula rasa. They encounter other forms of constituting and comprehending the world, which they to varying degrees replace, displace, and reconfigure. Some things are effaced, they disappear. Others are reorganized. Religion, an example I've used more than once. Maps and other technologies make it possible to see things that could not be seen before, but they don't necessarily displace other relationships to land and landscape. In short, modernity and its knowledges do not completely remake the world, and to the degree that they do not, modern knowledge remains inadequate to representing and understanding these worlds. That is, while modern knowledge has constituted our global modernity, it's never homologous with the entire world. Or to put it another way, the world that modern knowledge creates continues to sit alongside other worlds. This, it seems to me, is glaringly apparent in many parts of the non-West, but it is also true even in the heartlands of modernity. In the modern world, as in the non-Western world, in the modern Western world, as in the non-Western world, there are still realms of knowing and living that are part of the modern. They're not survivals of pre-modernity destined to eventually be swept away, but they are neither lived through nor are wholly accessible to us through the categories of the human sciences. The conclusion to be drawn is not that modern knowledge and the social sciences are wrong or merely European. That is not my argument at all, and nor is this some form of identity politics. The genealogy of modern knowledge, I have suggested, is undeniably Western. But that knowledge is now global, and with differences of degree is the heritage of most people. Global, however, is not the same thing as universal. It's not that this knowledge has risen above the circumstances of its production and revealed that it's true for all. On the contrary, the failure of the attempts to ground modern reason are more apparent today than ever before. Rather, This knowledge and the historical processes with which it is closely associated have, for good or ill, refashioned the world. While they serve to constitute a world in common, our global modernity, this world continues to sit alongside other ones, worlds to which the social sciences are only a limited guide. And I conclude by suggesting that modern knowledge and the social sciences that formalize it have constituted our modernity and are at once indispensable, but also never fully adequate to making sense of it.
Thank you, Sanjay. Well, the presentation's over, and I'd like to, although we are running out of time, we would like to take some questions from the floor. Would you? Yeah, probably. Right. Just 5 minutes or 10 minutes? Okay, we should. All right. Okay. Maxi first.
Maxi Spiegel. A couple of questions or comments. One, Susana talked about the process of innovative ideas being excluded. And I think what happens because of the hegemonic process, but I think at least in part what happens is that some of the most exciting and innovative ideas, not all of them by any means, are appropriated, they co-opted by the hegemon. And that ties to the issue of brain drain. So that when good ideas arise, at least some of them and their protagonists end up, and we heard reference to Spivak and others, sort of landing up in the hegemonic space, although the spatial metaphor is something we need to question. And yeah, the same in a way for Gordon. He talked about more, you talked about more and more anthropological researchers going abroad from home in India and China to do their research, but in a sense, they get co-opted too. And even as that happens, the US, and I point to the US in particular, tends, my apologies. I'm sitting next to a previous AAA president, the immediate past one. The US tends to produce more and more graduates who go out and either work abroad or work at home. And the question of visas, which has come up here in the context of this conference, is also important because some of those people don't get the opportunity to go and sort of sit in a home in Manchester and or a neighborhood of Manchester and find out what sort of to do the kind of ethnographic research which others might do. So the winner will not simply be one faction, but the whole of anthropology, you said, but that fails to recognize the economics of the situation too. I think I'll stop at that point. I had some comments for Michal, but I'll leave it at that.
Okay, I wish I had more time, but I think I first take all the questions from the floor, and after that, some of the panelists wish to respond. Okay. And this? Okay.
Go ahead. I'll be very short because I'm nervous when I speak English. Okay. When Professor Susana Narotzky in her speech has the current hegemonic way of anthropological knowledge production changed, at that moment I had a question for everyone here. That is, when I was a student, how has the course of history of anthropology been taught? And now, how do anthropologists teach this course, history of anthropology? Is it still the way like British tradition, American tradition, French tradition, and then a little bit at the end, the tradition of your own country? Okay, that's it.
Okay, the next one, Juliana.
Now, I am native Italian, my second language is French, but I'm a British anthropologist. Now, I think we are addressing two different set of issues, in my view. On the one hand, we have the problem of recognizing different anthropological traditions and of the ranking of intellectual production in other languages other than English. And then, on the other hand, there is the problem of communicating among scholars who speak different languages. Now, throughout history, we always had a predominant language. In the past, in Europe, it was Latin until the Middle Ages. And then, for a very long time, it was French. After the Second World War, English became the predominant language. Not because of the predominance, the political power of Britain, but of the United States. Now, North Atlantic English seems to be the language common to everybody, to people who want to communicate from different... So I ask the panel, how would you solve the problem of communicating when we have international congresses like this one? Should we have a panel in French, in Spanish, in Chinese, and then we will end up probably speaking to each other, not to people who don't speak the language. Another point about the economic hegemony, and it was mentioned by that China is becoming the economic power. So if the predominance of a language, international language, is linked to economic hegemony, are we going to learn Chinese in order to communicate at international conferences?
Okay, I think Lourdes. Yeah.
Sorry, I know it's a hurry. Yes, I am the immediate past president of the American Anthropological Association, and Muxi is my friend. I'm Virginia Dominguez. I know that the panelists know the extent to which I am sympathetic with the enormity of what you say, but I have to speak from a position not unrelated to the one that was just articulated, and it's a bit of a painful position. If I think about who are most of us who have been really pushing the idea of world anthropologies or deparochializing the Anglo-American world, I think Michal actually said this. Most of us have been trained in US or UK universities. And we have to admit that, and I do not know how we teach. I suspect that we tend to teach and to cite those people and those works that we were taught to value. And so we are in a conundrum. I think there is a great deal of complicity at the same time that we are trying to lead a deparochializing charge. And so Susana is absolutely right. I do not know that there has been that much change. Most of the Americans who are here are wonderfully dedicated, or they are actually based in US universities, but neither born nor raised in the US, right? A lot of my colleagues in the US do not even know of the existence of the IUAES. What is that about?
Okay, that lady in the middle.
Georgina Gore, but I'm British, but I work in France, so the bicultural, bilingual issue is interesting, but it's not that I want to address. It's a follow-on from your remarks about the content of teaching and the previous question about history, but it picks up from Gordon Matthews' comment about the dissemination through the changes brought about by internet. One of the questions that I ask myself constantly faced with first-year undergraduate students or second-year is, I think that we of a certain age live in a different world. I think the young today with technologies have a totally different frame to things, which is not a frame, but kind of simultaneous multiple perspective. And I wonder how we can use this in our teaching to actually transform our perspective on anthropology to engage with the kind of issues that we've been tackling. And the problem I'm faced with is that being an old British social anthropologist based in France, I reproduce all these things. I don't know what to do with this population because I have an old idea of, I suppose, teacher-student relationships, that the panoptic model that was put up is the frame for teaching in the kind of situation that we're sitting in today, where we're down there and students are all over the place, but they no longer engage with us. So I don't have any answer, but I have answers, but I have just a question. And I think that if we can transform our modes of teaching, we will all also have to change the way in which we address content. But I have no idea, and I'm kind of near retirement. But I throw it out.
Okay, I can take only one more question. Well, therefore, I don't know who insists. Noel?
Noel Sarger, I had the benefit of being closest to the microphone. Sorry about that. I'm a Belgian-Spanish anthropologist, trained, as people would say, in the US, but I got most of my experience from my fieldwork sites in Tanzania and Indonesia. That's equal part of my training. I just wanted to make a comment that I found it a very interesting panel and a very interesting set of questions, but I want to remind us all that it's very easy and it's very cozy to think of these issues as issues that anthropologists are dealing with. This is issues that most scientists are dealing with. And if we want to change these things, if we only do this within anthropology, then we will lose the battle. Because the battle is not being fought within anthropology. The battle is fought outside anthropology. And this would be a plea to also network with many, many scholars inside social sciences, humanities, but also the hardcore sciences who are dealing exactly with the same issues. And to just give you a brief example, a couple of months ago, there was a San Francisco Declaration on Research Assessment that deals exactly with the issues that Gordon Mathews was bringing up. While the anthropologists were very much absent, I mean, IASA was one of the associations involved in actually creating that assessment. So it's a warm plea to open your eyes and also look beyond anthropology. Thank you.
All right, I have got and go back to the panel and just somebody respond to some of the questions. We cannot take care of everything.
I just want to say that about the question of dissemination and communication, there is a lot of experiences already in going or done of doing Congress in different languages. There is also actually what Gustavo Ribeiro talked about, this experience of doing a webinar in different languages, French, English, Spanish, and Portuguese. And also what I talked about the vision of doing a science with the consideration of having our students, you know, to do for me to teach in French and having content in French, but also to expose them to different languages and to different issues. For instance, by the means of the dictionary. So I do not think we have one solution in one time, but we have many solutions we are working on and trying to do something different than the Anglo center word we are living with. I just want to say that.
Yes. Is this working?
Ah. Yes.
Okay. It's on. Yeah. Okay. On the issues of language cooptation and all these questions. First, I think it's very different. English as a language of communication and English as a language of production. I think that knowledge
can be communicated in a different language that is not the native language of the person producing that knowledge, even if it's communicated in a so-so way or manner, but it's very different to produce knowledge in a language which is not the native language. And it, I think that's something we need to address. It's very different to write a paper in Spanish and send it to a journal and have it reviewed and then maybe translated if it's accepted, than to try and write in English or to try and do it in a different language. So I think we have to differentiate the language of communication in the meetings. It's obvious, I said so. It's important to communicate and have a unique language. Also, I must say that Latin disappeared precisely because it had these problems. So, I mean, we have to bear that in mind. I think experimentation is very important. So I really think that even if it doesn't work perfectly, these experiments like the Anthropen or the webinar we are trying to put together, or these multilingual journals which exist like Ethnographica in Portugal, etc., are good ideas that we need to pursue. Co-optation, yes, but not only. I mean, there is both marginalization, and I think that's very strong, and then also co-optation. But generally, those that get co-opted are those that manage to get into the Anglo publication. So there is already a step that has been... And also, it's not only co-optation, because these people who get incorporated or encompassed, as Michal was saying, also are sites of resistance, in a way. And I think that Virginia is an example, but there are many others, no? So I want to say, and then last, just to Virginia, about the training aspect. It's not exactly, it doesn't work always exactly that way, because many of us who have been subsequently trained in the US or in the UK come from a previous training in other countries, which we are meant to abandon when we get to the US or the UK. In fact, we're meant to forget about those people we were reading and those people who were important to us, and just get into the mainstream of the Anglo-American academy.
But that doesn't happen.
Okay.
Gustavo? Well, some forget more than others. It depends.
We are running out of time, but Gustavo, okay, as a convener...
John's going to throw us out of here in a second.
Are you going to... Well, it's pretty late.
Okay. Yeah, never mind. I won't say anything at all then. Do we have time?
Okay.
Give me 20 seconds. I'll speak very quickly. I'm sorry about those people who aren't native speakers of English. Muggsy, you're right. I couldn't agree more. I had 15 minutes, but the complexities, you're absolutely correct. You asked a really interesting question about theory, and as I could understand it from up here, it's very strange reading anthropological theory, because when I look it over, it's like great works of art. I can't tell what's great or not unless somebody tells me. And so when we read, for example, theory in a theory course, if you read Radcliffe Brown and had no idea if it was great or not, or Marx or anybody, would you know it's great? I question whether you would or not. So the question for you is to look, use your own critical intelligence to evaluate stuff of your own tradition as well as that of the Anglo-American tradition. Use your own judgment. Don't trust your teachers.
Okay? That's very good.
Economics, will we need Chinese? Probably not, because the Chinese economy is going to hit a brick wall probably in 10 to 15 years, just as Japanese did. If the Japanese economy continued to grow, maybe Yamashita Shinji would be up here speaking in Japanese. I don't think so, because there is a lag between economics and the culture following it, a lag of roughly 30 to 40 years. Who knows? We'll have a more multipolar world, whether that gives way, whether that causes English to give way or not, I can't predict. But you won't need to learn Chinese, your grandkids may or may not. Okay, lastly, the question that Noel raised about beyond anthropology. Of course, these transcend anthropology, but anthropology is in a particularly tricky place because it's both a science and a humanities. So what about this issue of are we following very hard sciences where I think English can be justified more as a universal language, or are we a discipline that, no, we need to stick to our traditions in their own language, and because of our place in the middle, that's what gives this question of language particular poignance in terms of anthropology, I think, although you're absolutely right.
Okay.
So much has been said that I don't. Again, I really don't know what to say. So, language, hopefully it will be Polish. But at some point, even the Pope said that it has an impression that God speaks English. And I. History teaching and theory teaching. Yes, there is an obvious domination going on in various places. People, I can say from my experience that the history of anthropology is mainly history of British, French, and American anthropology. Hundreds of books were translated into Polish from French and English, no other languages. There are very rare other books translated. And whatever you try to do, it is really difficult. You hit the wall because all the reviewers, they say, well, this is not important for a translation. What I think is very important is this, that we should encourage peripheral anthropologists collaboration that somehow, not maybe totally overpass, but overpass a little bit this central anthropologists. When I ask my students, who come to my class, and after class it has to be changed, but when they come to my class and I ask, do you know any name of other Central and Eastern European anthropologists? They usually don't know even the name. They have never read any paper from these anthropologists. But of course they read everything what Clifford wrote and, you know, all these savants. It is okay, but I think it shouldn't be so, and it should go in these many directions. Thank you very much.
Okay.
When there is a power system operating, the problem is how do you change it? And it's not a very easy answer. Do you change it from without or you change it from within? I think that you change it from both loci. So this is not a movement of exclusion, it's a movement of inclusion. So we never said that we want to exclude the British or the American anthropologists of the game. We want them to be our partners, and they are, and to change themselves. So I can see it's happening right now. Do it again, do it again.
I hope it stops at this gesture.
The problem of language is basically what I call the paradox of transnational communication. In order to communicate with diverse language speakers, we need a single language. And this is not a choice. History gave us this language, English, so we have to use it. And thank God it's much easier than Mandarin, you know. Well, we do need a common language, and this is the only one that is disposable. The problem of style is a more difficult one because it really entails homogenization, and that's a loss.
Okay. Do you have something?
Just one point. Just, okay. In response to the last gentleman. I mean, I
please
agree.
Be brief.
Yeah,
please.
I will. I agree that we need to go beyond anthropology, and I'm from outside of it. But one thing, it would be interesting, it will play out differently in each discipline. And I think at some point it would be interesting to get together and have a conversation where those interested in provincializing or parochializing Europe in history, in philosophy, talk to anthropology, in sociology, and so on. because, you know, we're engaged in something common, but disciplinary inflections do matter, and it will play out differently, and it would be interesting to have that conversation. On a smaller scale, Gustavo and I organized something a few years ago involving anthropologists and people who did area studies, but it would be interesting to include a broader range of disciplines in such a conversation.
Okay, thank you very much. It's almost the time for the closing ceremony. It's supposed to start at 11:30. So please be here with us for the closing ceremony. And I just would like to thank you all the panelists and for everybody who participated in this roundtable. Thank you very much.